Giving this presentation, I would like to show my appreciation in acknowledging the 18 million men and women under arms during World War II. Of the 18 million, about 8 million were non-combatants who did a fantastic job in supporting our combat soldiers in numbers of about 3 to 1. I enlisted in the U.S. Army Air Force, I can't believe this, 75 years ago, since I'm 39 and old, on November 6, 1942. At that time, our country was just coming out of a Great Depression. Some of you of my generation are here today, I guess, and remember a living wage for a family of four was $25 a week. A week of groceries cost $5. Unemployment was 25%. After the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, the world changed. Our whole country went to war, whether it was defense plans, the draft, or volunteers to the military. This was total war. Patriotism was in the air. We could not lose this war. Only God knows where we would be today if Hitler had been victorious. I was an 18-year-old freshman at Ilmer College, totally wound up to get into the fight. I wanted to be a fighter pilot, my hero Eddie Rickenbacker from the First World War. At that time, the draft was 21 years of age. In order to enlist under the age of 21, you had to have a signature from your parents or a guardian. Since my parents wanted me to continue my education, they didn't wish to sign. So I had my uncle, who was a World War I veteran, sign for me. When I took the original physical, I passed. However, my eyesight was 20/40. As a result, when I applied to flight school, I was rejected because 20/20 vision was required. I ended up being assigned to the Quartermaster Corps that was attached to the U.S. Army Air Corps as an inventory clerk. I was devastated beyond belief. Waycross, Georgia Air Force Base was my first assignment, a base where segregation was very strict, which I was never aware of at the time. My family had a black housekeeper who was a fantastic cook, and after a few tasteless meals at our mess hall, I decided to sneak over to the blacks' mess hall to get a quality meal. They greeted me with open arms, and the meal was great. Someone reported me to the commanding officer. I was ordered not to visit the segregated mess hall again, and I was placed on KP duty for a week. I had to clean out the grease pit. I shipped to England on the Queen Mary in March of 1943 with 10,000 other troops. We received two meals a day, and as a private first class, I was billeted in the hole next to the pumps, which were pounding all night. I ate a box of chocolate bars, and it was constipated for about a week. I landed in Scotland, where I boarded a train to transport us to our base at Colchester, England. We were given weak tea with powdered milk. Not only was I not sure what I was drinking, but I could not understand a word being spoken by the Scottish women serving us. After about 3 months of very low morale, working as a simple clerk instead of fighting a war, a fantastic opportunity arose that I thought would truly answer my prayers. It seems that the bombardier navigator, sitting in the nose of the aircraft, only protected by plexiglass, were either killed or wounded faster than they could be replaced. A bombardier navigator and gunnery school was being established with a 90-day course. Normally, it took about 9 months to a year before being assigned to combat. So here I was, 18 years old, never even been in an airplane, taking a crash course in all three categories, and assigned to combat missions in a little over 90 days. Of course, my acceptance would not be incomplete until I passed my physical. So I was determined to get in this darn war, and I managed to sneak into the exam room and memorize the 20/20 line of the night shift. The letters were NDHRCLAK, and I'll never forget it. I passed. put my glasses over to get in my position. There was such a critical shortage of my position that I was forced to fly with four crews. Therefore, I completed 65 bombing missions weeks before any of my original crew. The nose compartment was so small, the bomber and navigator was not able to wear a parachute. In order to bail out, I had to crawl through a small passageway, wait for the co-pilot to get out of his seat, climb back to the radio room, put on my chute, and jump out through the bomb bay. This was almost impossible with the centrifugal force of the plane going down. But we did have quite a panoramic view surrounded by plexiglass in the nose. A loading list was issued each day showing the missions you were flying and your position in your flight of six aircraft. I have one of these loading lists on the table. On one of our missions, we had the honor of having the famous war correspondent, Ernie Pyle, as an observer and a Pathé news photographer to photograph our bombs striking the target. It was decided that after my bombs hit the target, I would look back and give the photographer the high sign. I didn't know this clip would be shown in theaters across the USA. My parents were at the Colonial Theater in Allentown when the scene flashed across the screen. And my parents stood up and screamed, "That's my son, that's my son." The whole theater was in an uproar. Many of our missions were flown at dawn. My position as a bombardier navigator placed me, as I said, in the nose surrounded by plexiglass. As we crossed the English Channel, the sun was rising, and the AEF, American Expeditionary Force radio station, opened their broadcast with the national anthem. What a feeling. I was so proud to be an American, given the opportunity to participate in fighting our enemy. My original combat mission tour was supposed to be 35 missions. As I reached about 30, they raised it to 50 missions. After flying over 40, they raised it to 65. All this was caused by the lack of replacements, especially bombardier navigators. On my fifth mission target was an ordnance depot in Liège, Belgium. The Germans normally used 88 millimeters. In this case, they used 105. The bursts were larger than the planes. When we were hit by a shrapnel, it felt like being in a car with big bricks being thrown at it. Well, we hit our target, but our fuel tanks were punctured, causing a rapid loss of fuel. In order to conserve fuel, we could not maintain our speed or altitude, so we flew over the North Sea to a small landing strip that jutted out of the English coast called King's Lynn. There I was, an 18-year-old kid, being responsible for the lives of our crew and the plane. We made it to the strip with emergency flares shooting red flames, and we landed. When we landed, we were able to pull off the runway when our engines quit. We literally made it by seconds. I was a hero that day. My crew flew the mission on D-Day, June 6, 1944, at about 8,000 feet. I could see the longest armada in world history stretching from England to the coast of France. We had over 8,000 ships. I have a photo of me crossing the channel with the invasion fleet coming over. Some 8,000 ships were in the invasion fleet. There was nothing like it before or since. Our targets were German troops in a railroad marshaling yard near Caen. Due to low cloud cover, we had to reduce our altitude to 4,000 feet, considerably increasing our vulnerability to any aircraft. We were a part of a flight of six aircraft, each carrying 8 500-pound bombs. With hundreds of aircraft flying above us, we were also in danger of being struck by our Allied bombers. I remember when I opened my bomb bay doors, when our final approach to the target, all hell broke loose, with German anti-aircraft cannons shooting 40-millimeter tracer projectors. I could actually see the gunners who were shooting at me. Looking between my feet, the tracers seemed to be coming right at me, but actually flashed under us. I felt like I was sitting on top of a fountain. Upon returning from dropping our bombs, we again encountered heavy enemy fire. This time a piece of flak, about 4 inches in diameter, tore between my feet and out the top of the plexiglass, destroying my navigational maps on the floor and missing my head by inches. I was more upset that I lost my navigation map than I was at my near this disaster. During the Battle of the Bulge, my plane was shot down twice in 1 week. Talking about an eye-opener. I was shot down during a historic battle for Bastogne, Belgium on December 23rd, and again on December 28, 1944. In both cases, the pilot, co-pilot, and I stayed with the plane, allowing the other crew members to bail out. I have to tell, the idea of going down with your ship is daunting, and the horrors of having done so remain with me today. Flying at 12,000 feet, an 88-millimeter shell pierced our right engine cylinder. There was a huge noise, but not the noise we expected. The shell failed to explode. Needless to say, we knew the hand of God was with us, and our conversation with a maker picked up dramatically. However, our engine was in flames, shooting back towards the tail. In order to kill the flames, we had to dive 6,000 feet with bursts of flak all around us. You've seen it in the old war movies of an era. It looks just like what you've seen, only 10 times scarier if you've been there. Particularly if you're in the nose, where I was, you have a rather unusual point of view of the approaching ground. Being in the nose of that plane, staring straight down at the rapidly approaching ground, with only me and with only plexiglass and me between us, and disaster made me reconsider how we've lived our life. My body was pinned back by centrifugal force. My eardrums were splitting from the whining of the left engine and the deafening noise of the wind whipping through and around the plane, making the plunge towards terra firma seem like an eternity before we pulled out of the dive. I was absolutely numb when we barely managed to sit down safely on an emergency field. Later, on December 28th, during the same period of the Battle of the Bulge, our targets were German troops near Bastogne. This time, our aircraft was riddled with inflicting serious damage to the plane's hydraulic systems and severely wounding our top turret gun. After dropping my bombs, I volunteered to render first aid. However, the wound was located in his groin, and it was so large that his tourniquet would not work, so I did the only thing I could do. I stuffed gauze with sulfur powder into the wound. The bleeding stopped because at our altitude of 12,000 feet, it was cold enough to coagulate the blood. However, when we dropped below the freezing altitude, our 18-year-old gunner literally bled to death. By now, our hydraulic systems were inoperable, and we crash-landed into a rock-strewn, snow-covered field with our wheels up. Someone up there must have been watching over me, since I came through both of the missions without a scratch. However, I was mentally and psychologically exhausted. Being outshot constantly and crash landing twice, I guess that'll do that to a man. After an examination by our squadron flight surgeon, he ordered I be sent to a so-called rest home. We called it a flak house for 15 days. Since our air base was in France, I was flown to Scotland, where I was taken to a magnificent 12th century castle. There I was escorted to a beautiful private room with glossy hardwood floors and a real bed with starch white sheets. Of course, we were living in muddy tents all this time. To top it all, civilian clothes were provided, which consisted of a light blue suit, white shirt, red tie, and black shoes. I love my uniform, but I must say it was a relief to get out of it. I quickly dressed and rushed down to a large assembly hall where there were about 100 men dressed in a light blue suit, white shirt, red tie, and black shirt. This is a British operation and was provided to all the guests. That evening, as I looked around, I had a surreal feeling that I had never experienced before or since. As I walked into the assembly hall, I thought, war is hell. But sometimes it's a price of freedom. It was a price the soldiers, would have been called the greatest generation, paid in World War II. Let us honor and recognize the price that other generations paid in Korea, Vietnam. It's a price being paid by today's greatest as they fight for the American traditions, ideas, and ideals of freedom in the far-off lands around the world. I came to realize that the greatest generation will always be embodied in the hearts and minds, the souls of whoever our fighting troops are, and whoever they may be. We are able to assemble here today because of what they have accomplished and are doing over there. I cannot help but believe that General MacArthur had it right. When his farewell speech to the nation, he gazed down over the crowd gathered to hear his final address, and he spoke those immortal words, "Old soldiers never die, they just fade away." So as we gather here in this tiny spot of a mighty land, let us raise our voices in prayer and ask God to bless all our fallen heroes. And may God bless the United States of America. May she remain the shining star in the hearts of all mankind, now and forever, evermore. Thank you very much.